Maranatha.
Jesus is coming again.
Maranatha.
Jesus is coming again.
Truly, Jesus is coming again.
Amen.
Signs are fast fulfilling before our eyes, and we can visibly see it in so many countries of Asia. We can see visibly in so many countries of Africa. We can see visibly in so many countries of Europe. We can see them in so many countries of America, the continent. We can see such signs happening in the entire world. They are all preaching to us, telling to each one of us that Jesus is coming and that He is even at the door.
Amen.
I want to welcome you all into today's celebration day. We are here to thank God for the love He had shown, for the protection He had given us from last year to this year. And because of that, we want to thank God for that. And we also want to thank the Lord because today we will ask the many blessings that we as youth need in order to overcome the challenges of our daily lives. Thank you, youth, for the beautiful presentation. Those who have made it in the morning, they have been truly blessed.
Amen.
And truly the Lord is with the youth of BJ Church.
Amen.
The message for today, or even before I go into that, I also want to thank the church for giving us this time of speaking to church as young. We thank you so much for that.
Amen.
The message for today is entitled, The Hero That Ran Away. Looking at that, it seems a little bit contradictory because it's believed that the hero is someone who is known, you know, who goes in front, who goes to the fight, who is not afraid of anything. But then we look at the hero who ran away. How can that be? And I was trying to go through some dictionaries, just to find out a little bit more about the meaning of a hero. I came up with something which says, a hero deliberately courageously overcomes obstacles for the benefit of others without regard to personal consequences. Conquered obstacles are the only qualifying credentials of heroes and the measure of one's true leadership. We often think heroes are those who run to the fight, but today we will understand that often heroes are those who engage in organized retreats. Church, I want to invite you, before we go any further, I want us to see the background of this man who runs away, and even after running away, he becomes a hero. Shall we have our Bible open in the book of Genesis 37, verse 2? Projected there. These are the generation of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brothers. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Shall we bow our head for a short word of prayer? Our Heavenly Father, Your word has been read. Now blow us with Thy truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Church, it's interesting to know that the lifestyle of a mother actually impacts, you know, it has an influence on the baby, it had an influence on you as a baby. And what you did as a baby, you know, somehow had an influence on your childhood. And what you did during your childhood, it actually had an influence on your adulthood. That's why the Bible says in the Proverbs, in the book of Proverbs 22 verse 6, train up a child in the way he should go. And when he is old, he will not depart. Those are wise words of the Bible. And I've got a question for you. If that is true, If one stage influences another one, my question for you is, what were you up to when you were 17? I don't know about you, but if in a second I can tell you about my life, you know, to me when I was in that stage of 17, it was the time when, you know, I was full of energy, the way we say it, right? And I feel like the blood is boiling, and I just wanted to do anything which would come in front of me. And I believe it was the time that I was actually dating two ladies at the same time. And not only that, but I was also a little bit good at school, because by the time I was in grade 10, and I was actually the best mathematician in the school in a foreign country I started, but something beautiful happened to me in that stage. It was actually when I gave my life to Jesus.
Amen.
I was baptized, and it was really a blessing, a blessing, a blessing. Now, I want you to listen to this. 2013 was a great year for a 17-year-old Nick from England. He sold an app he developed to shorten programs run by a mobile device. Yahoo bought his app for $30 million just from a 17-year-old man. Isn't that amazing? Church, we thank you for giving the time for the youth, because this is the time that we need to put our energy in church activities.
Amen.
When you engage us in church, we will use our energy in church, but if we are not using it in church, we might use it somewhere else.
Amen.
And thank you for that chance. So we can therefore conclude a little bit that 17 is a time of fun, it's a time of growth, time of plan, time of friends, dating, enthusiasm for life, but most important of all, it's a time when God speaks in powerful ways. Brothers and sisters, I'm struck with the impact of the opening words of Genesis 37, verse 2. It begins with Joseph being 17 years old. You know, the generation, it's amazing to know that the generation of Joseph, of Israel, of Jacob, it begins with Jacob, but it continues with Joseph. And by the time Joseph was only 17, according to the Jewish culture, 17 was still a young man, but was considered to be a man. That's why I believe that the troubles that Joseph faced in his life might be the same troubles that the youth face today. And the techniques that he used to overcome such temptations and troubles might be the same techniques we might use today as well. If we can continue in the book of Genesis 37, verse 3, they still look at the background of this runaway man, probably they've got an idea, who is this runaway man? Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. You know, I was trying to find out why did that Israel only loved Joseph and not the other brothers, not the other sons. And as a matter of fact, he makes him a coat of many colors. It had a great significance that by that time. So I came to a conclusion that Joseph was loved by Israel because Joseph was the son of his old age. But if we go a little bit down, we will understand that there are many more reasons why Israel loved Joseph more than his brothers. If you can remember what we read in the book of Genesis 37 verse 2, we will find out that Joseph brought some kind of evil report of his brothers to the father. So it can give us a clue that when the brothers of Joseph would spend time in doing illicit things, Joseph would spend time reading the Bible. It gives us an indication that when the brothers would listen to worldly music, Joseph could listen to gospel music.
Amen.
It gives us an impression that when the brothers of Joseph could date just about any lady could face, I mean they could find on the street, Joseph would date ladies of the same faith. And because of that, Joseph was loved by his father. Joseph decided to have a consecrated life with God. And Israel loved Joseph. And I believe that God calls the youth of today to live a consecrated life as well. And a consecrated life is nothing else than giving our wants, our needs, our desires, you know, what our body truly craves for in the mighty hands of Jesus on a daily life. And because of that, you know the story, the brothers did not like just, you know, each time they could look at Joseph, they could just feel something against this young man because, I mean, there was too much difference, and they began floating, thinking, but what can we do so that we may get rid of our brother? And among them, they were actually fighting, what do we do? Do we kill him? What do we do? But some said, no, let's not be guilty of his blood, but let's find out some other kind of ways now to have, you know, him away from us. And they decide to put him into the well. But some other time then they realize that there's this group of Ishmaelites who are actually going to Egypt. And these are the people who could buy slaves and who could actually trade slaves. So I want the church now to follow me. Shall we open our Bibles in the book of Genesis 39, verse 24? Actually, the scripture is not in the slide because I want to make sure that we open our Bibles because I want to hear some Bible noise. Genesis is just the first book of the Bible. Genesis 39 verse 1 to 4, it goes, and Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him of the hands of Ishmaelites, which had brought him down there. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. And Joseph found grace in his sight, and he served him, and he made him overseer over his house, and all that he had, he put into his hand, except his wife. You know, when I was reading this, I felt so, you know, I discovered that, you know, even though Joseph was sold to Egypt, he actually did not sell the principles he had learned at home. He was sold to Egypt, but what he had learned from his parents, it was stuck with him and was actually in that same relationship with God. Parents, we have got a big responsibility to train up a child when he's just a child. Joseph was away from his parents, but it didn't mean that he had to exchange the values he had learned from his parents. And here we see that God was with Joseph because his relationship with him was a constant surrender in the hand of God. And as he was doing his daily activities, God would bless Joseph.
Amen.
And the Bible says, whatever Joseph would touch, it would become a blessing. And because of that, Joseph became a blessing in the house of Potiphar. My question to you is today, do you think you are a blessing to your surrounding? Do people feel attracted when you are in their presence? Or when they see you, they feel like running away, they just don't feel comfortable to be where you are? Joseph, God blessed him, and whatever he touched, it was a project. You know, it was just prospering. And I'm also reminded what David says in his book of Psalms 1, verse 1. He says, blessed is the man who sits not in the counsel of ungodly, but that one who thinks of the word of God, and he meditates in the word of God day and night, because it shall be like a tree planted by the river side, whose leaves shall never wither, and whatever he does shall prosper.
Amen.
So we've got the formula, brothers and sisters. The Bible is so clear. We read chapter after chapter, Bible after, book after book, it just dies. days were going on and days were passing, and Joseph was there doing his daily work. God was there blessing him. And there was someone in the house who was actually not doing anything, who ended up doing something. And this same person, you know, was just looking at this young man who was blessed by God, who was just doing good thing, you know. And I'm talking about Potiphar's wife. She wasn't doing anything. Rather, she was just there trying to see at people what they were doing. And she was attracted when she saw this young man, Joseph, you know. Friends, allow me to say that women are really beautiful, and I think that's why we guys want to go on in life. But also allow me to say there are some young men who are really beautiful, and Joseph was a handsome boy, the Bible confirms that. And the way, and Potiphar's wife could really not stand looking at Joseph. I believe maybe as Joseph was waking and suddenly felt a little bit tired and wanted just to give some swimming, just to cut his t-shirt, and Potiphar's wife could just look and could not stand, and some kind of ideas come to mind, but this boy, if I can just give him a hug, you know, day by day she started thinking about it. It was actually piling up in her mind until a day came that she decided actually to sleep with Joseph. She was looking for a chance. And the Bible says, if you look for a chance to sin, you will find it. And she was, let's read, that's what the Bible says. James 39, verse 10 to 12. It says, and it came to pass, as she spoke to Joseph day by day, that he hearkened not unto her to lie by her or to be with her. And it came to pass about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business. And there was no one of the men of the house there within. And she caught him by his garment, saying, lie with me. And he left his garment in her hand and fled and got him out. She was looking for a chance. And the Bible says, and this time when she looked, no one was at home. The only person who was being expected was Joseph. She looked at the time. Joseph would be maybe arriving at 8 o'clock because he was a punctual person. Maybe after 8:30 someone will come in. So just when Joseph comes, I'll just grab him. She didn't have time, you know, because I believe when people approach someone, right, you have to come with kind words and, you know, you're so beautiful. She did not have that time because she knew someone was going to come, so that was a chance she grabbed. The Bible says, she grabbed. Is that true? She did. Why did you do that? Why did she do that? Because time was running fast, and today is the time that you should lie with this young man. You know, I actually thought that only guys could do that. Remember dating? But even women can do that. That's the world we're living in today. Yeah. And to my surprise, I said, but how come Joseph runs away just like that? Sometimes when we are caught in temptation, you take a little longer to discover if you are really being tempted. Or you know, it's probably a chance. You get the point. You get a bit confused, but to Joseph, there was no confusion. Do you know why? Because to Joseph, God was not only, you know, I love this. When I think about it, this is so beautiful. To Joseph, God was not simply a firefighter who could be called to extinguish the fire of temptation. But to Joseph, God was his constant friend in every hour and in every crisis. And because of that, he actually overcame. There is the man running away. How can the hero run away? It's such a chance. In today's world, I believe the young people, when they look at this, some people, they think they didn't know what they lost. But actually, they don't know what he gained after that. There is something great behind every temptation. There is something great behind any temptation. You know, I'm actually reminded of some brothers who think that they are so strong when the temptation is there, they think they are the Avengers or they are the new Rambos, that they can actually face temptation. You will not make it. And I'm also reminded of those brothers when they are tempted, they look at temptation, okay, it's okay. They actually walk, they leave the temptation, they walk in style to leave the temptation. And there are those who know that I'm in the territory of the devil, and they walk away, but they leave their address behind so that the temptation can catch up them in 2 weeks' time. It's so interesting, but the Bible says that Joseph ran, he actually fled, he ran away. He didn't have time to think of that, he ran away. Friend, there's something that we can learn out of this. Joseph ran away. He seemed to be a loser by this point in time, right? But he didn't. One thing we learn from this is, if the temptation is repeated, Bible reading must be repeated. If the temptation is repeated, the prayer has to be repeated. If the temptation is repeated, the going to church has to be repeated.
Amen.
Joseph fled but did not yield to temptation. He followed the scriptural guidance which says we must escape from the following things. Escape from the impurity, according to 1 Corinthians 6:17. Flee from idolatry, 1 Corinthians 10 verse 14. And I love this. This is the most important one because it affects the Jew today. Flee also youthful lusts. Friends, sorry, I want to say this. It's, you know, sometimes as I speak to fellow friends, and we really say that when if Jesus comes today, this time, I think the youth, the majority of youth, I don't think they're going to make it to heaven. You know, it's so good to be youth these days because there's so much to do. Our elderly, so sorry, because in your times I think things were not like that. But in our days, so much is happening. And just sometimes you don't even have time to sleep. It's true, we are busy as if we are producing. Friends, there's a great lesson you can learn from Joseph today. There's a great lesson we can learn from Joseph today because the troubles that he faced are similar to the troubles we face today. We live in a time where we lack, you know, we live in a crisis of lack of confidence. Church, allow me to say this. We live in a generation that suffers from diarrhea of untrust. Everything is just untrust. It's the father or it's the husband who does not trust the wife. It's the wife who does not trust the husband. It's the parents who do not trust their children. It's the children who do not trust or not rely on their parents. It's the leaders who do not trust their people. It's the people who do not trust their leaders. It's the boyfriend who does not trust the girlfriend. It's the girlfriend who does not trust the boyfriend. It's a chaotic situation we're living in today. And listen to this. It's in the Patriarchs and Proverbs. It's a very beautiful thing. It says, and faithfulness should be characterized to characterize our lives in small details as well as in big matters. The integrity in a small things that we overcome. The realization of small acts of faithfulness and small actions of kindness rejoice the path of life. And when we have finished our work on earth, we will verify that each of the little duties faithfully performed exerted an influence for good. God calls today's young people to be a trustworthy people, to be reliable, and to be the people who actually will be confident in the unfailing promises of God. Because Joseph obeyed God, because Joseph did not sleep with Potiphar's wife, Potiphar's wife came up with an idea on how to accuse Joseph. And Joseph was considered to be someone who had raped Potiphar's wife. So sad. Because Potiphar trusted Joseph, but then Joseph wanted to rape, it was something too much big. And deep down personally, I think Potiphar, he believed in his wife, but not so much because he knew Joseph. But then he decided to believe what his wife said so that he could not hurt himself. And he takes Joseph, he goes to the prison. You know, Joseph had so many reasons to complain. People, they say, but God, I'm obeying you. You are my friend. I've tried the old things to be obedient to you. I've even run away, you know, which is not easy. And yet you allow me to go into the prison. Joseph could have, he had so many reasons. But, you know, we just don't understand when things happen. We just don't understand when things happen. And God will look at Joseph and will say, Joseph, it's true. You don't understand what's happening to you, but just wait a little longer. Joseph, you don't understand, you are in a prison. It's because I want you to be a little bit there while I'm busy preparing a new position for you. Joseph, you're in the prison because it's time for you to be there so that you may learn what it means to be in the prison. And when you are in the position that I'm preparing for you, you will actually understand the position of why you are there. You know, when I was reading this, I felt like maybe some of us today are, you know, maybe some of us are also in the prison. Sometimes you don't understand what is happening in your life. It seems as if you pray, but the more you pray, it seems that God's not answering your prayer. And it seems that the more you pray, it's actually the contrary. It seems nothing is happening, you're even going backwards. You know, I'm actually reminded when Jesus was actually crucified and darkness was covering the earth, and Jesus said, Father, why have you forsaken me? And as you can read from Ellen G. White's books, it says it was actually when the Father was closer to Jesus. And sometimes when you think you're in a prison, it's actually the time when God is closer to you. He's about to give to you what you should have. You remember what is written in the book of Jeremiah 29 verse 11? God says, for I know the plans I have for you. Friends, tell me, didn't God know the plans he had for Joseph? And when Joseph had to go through all these things, that was their need. We may never understand the way God wants us to be there where we work out. But today, the message says, it might be hard, it might be difficult, but let's learn to depend upon the word of God. Joseph is there, sent to the prison, and God looks at Joseph and says, Joseph, just a little longer, for you are about to be there. And then God sees that the time is broken, that Joseph should now do what I want him to do there in Egypt. God gives these dreams to these two men, the baker and the cupbearer. And you know, one thing that is so beautiful, because Joseph was always with God, even in the prison, Joseph was also made to be the ruler. It's good to really trust God. Yes, and suddenly these two brothers, they wake up from their slumps. They felt so sad, and Joseph could really look at them. One was on the other side, another one was on the other side. Because he was a nice person, Joseph was a nice person. He went to them and said, what is it that is troubling you? I don't know, but it's troubling. Please tell me, for the Lord that I serve will give you the meaning of the dream. And the cupbearer explains the dream. And Joseph, filled with the power of God, he gives the interpretation of the dream and says, after 2 days, you'll leave this place and you'll be with the king, and you will be restated. Previous position, you always be working with the king. And the baker listens to that and says, okay, please, can you also interpret my dream? What's your dream? He explains the dream, and Joseph says, unfortunately, after 3 days, you'll be taken out of the jail, and you're going to be slaughtered. And after 3 days, everything happens exactly the way Joseph had interpreted. But when Joseph was interpreting the cupbearer's dream, he says, when you are with your king, please remember me. Remember me. And God looks at the time and says, now that's the time that Joseph's faith should be rewarded. And God gives now this dream to the king. The dream that made Joseph to go to Egypt, even if in the first instance he did not understand. And the dream, the man becomes a little bit, you know, the dream wakes up, I mean, the king, Pharaoh wakes up, and, you know, he feels a little bit Father, what's the meaning of this dream? And I believe he tried to search for the best person who attained that time, maybe for the people who were holding, you know, their degrees or their diplomas or PhD or whatever it is. There was no one to actually give the explanation the way he wanted. And the cupbearer remembered that when he was in the jail, there was someone who was actually filled with the presence of God, who gave interpretation to his dream and said, King, live at peace, for there is someone who can help you. You know, and the king becomes a bit excited. Please go and call this young man to give an interpretation of the dream. And you know, this time Joseph leaves the prison no longer to listen to Potiphar, because Potiphar is so small for Joseph this time. Joseph goes to the king himself and he meets the king, and the king pay attention when Joseph, I don't know which school Joseph went to, I don't know, but I know that he listened to this some small young man who just came from the prison, and the king was there listening. Exactly. Oh, yeah, king, you know, there will be a time of famine 7 years, and then we need to do something needs to be done. We need to gather a lot of food, because otherwise it's going to be a problem. And he listens to this. Is this the problem of all the hunger that is going to face the earth? What do we need to do? And I believe he was going from side to side. You know, when kings think, they actually walk from side to side and thinking. He was thinking, but Peter's got two. He owns 2 degrees, a double degree, something like that. But Andrew has got a PhD, but he's not able to take up this position. And he was actually learning, thinking those who have got qualification to take up the position, he still cannot find anybody suitable for the position. Who else will take up that position if it's not the one who was thrown into the well? He didn't understand. Who else could take up that position if it's not the one whom we call a runaway man? Who else could take up that position if it's not the one who actually was put in the jail? And yet he didn't know why, he was just doing right. Who else could have taken that position? And the king looked at Joseph, and he feels heavy, and looked at Joseph. Who? You know, because he hoped in God, Joseph was victorious. Victorious in not being equal to his brothers. Victorious in not keeping hatred against his brothers. Victorious in not committing adultery with Potiphar's wife. Victorious in not rebelling against the accusation of Potiphar and his wife, victorious in interpreting the dreams of the prisoner of the king, victorious in interpreting the dreams of Pharaoh. Oh yes, waiting on the Lord, the runaway man is made a hero, the runaway man is made a governor with the fulfillment of the dream of God for him.
Amen.
Church, believe me, God has a dream for you too.
Amen.
I didn't believe this, but when I'll end this sermon, I'll prove to you that God has a dream for you too. But my question is, are you cooperating with God?
Amen.
Yes, Joseph was not taken to Egypt to be a simple servant. Oh yes. Or a butler to clean up furniture, or a jailer. Joseph was taken to Egypt to be a governor.
Amen.
Was to be head and not the tail, to be the first and not the last. You know, it pays to be faithful to God.
Praise God.
Amen. Even in the first moment, you do not understand. God always the word of
faith.
As I conclude, I want to share with you what happened personally to me. And I've learned that Christianity is about the personal experience you encounter with God.
Amen.
You know, some years ago, not so many years ago, I was doing my third year university in a foreign country, in America. And during my third year, it's the time that I begin to understand the love of God. You know, instead of reading the Bible, I could find it sweeter and sweeter. It's like I read 5 pages today, it's like I want to continue, but then it's too late. I have to continue the following day. And I was there reading the Bible. I read the Ellen G. White book, The Great Controversy, I read the Essays of Vengeance. It was so nice, and I said, I also want to fast. And I also fasted one day, and I could see that I had the power to fast for another day. And I fasted for 2 days without eating and drinking, and it was so amazing. And during that time of fast, I found myself actually preaching on the people who passing by the street. And do you know the love of God? I mean, something simple in a friendly way. And I found myself doing that. And I didn't understand why. But after 2 weeks, I have discovered that one of my tests I actually scheduled on the Sabbath. Previously, I've made a lot of tests as well, things like that. But this time, by the way, I was even baptized when I was 17. But I was not so strong because I think we grow every day. We grow every day. We don't accept the Lord. We must still have some failures, but we grow every day. And we want to reach there. So this time I said, I think I don't want to write a test on the Sabbath. I know I've done this, I've done that. According to what I read in the Bible, I don't want to write a test this time. No. I met my friends from the same university, the one who had the same friend, and I told them, you know, the tests actually scheduled on the Sabbath. Maybe what we do is, let's go to church and they will pray for us. You know, we Duke Central Church is a church like VGA. It's an international church where people from all over the world, they come and worship. When you give their problem, they receive it as if it was their problem. It's so nice. There's even one lady that I know, I cannot forget her name. She's called Margaret Sassoon. She said, son, don't worry, we will even fast for your problems. I said, wow. And we actually told them what the problem was and said, okay, we will pray for it. If you don't want to write the person yourself, we will pray for it. And God's going to perform miracle. So the church prayed. We normally also meet on Sundays morning just for prayers. We pray. 2 weeks are coming and you say, yeah, I think in 2 weeks time the Lord is going to change the day from Saturday to maybe Friday or to any day of the week. So we prayed. 2 weeks, nothing. The test was not, the day was not rescheduled. Son, don't worry, we will pray again. So we prayed, and she fasted, because sometimes I could not fast. And she even fasted 1 week and not fast. And she did that, but 1 week, no change. I mean, we continue to pray with the sincerity of heart to see if God can do something. 4 days we are approaching, no change. When 2 days were missing, we definitely knew that the change was not going to be there. And my friends, they came to see Isaac, I think, man, we just have to proceed because you understand that we are living in a foreign land and our parents, they need to send money. For me, they send money for my house, you know, they send money for the college, they send money for the transport, for everything. It's accounting, it's our major. If you don't do it, it's no longer 4 years, but it's 5 years. And I looked at them. I mean, you feel it because it's true. You understand? It's really true. And it's hard. And most of us, we don't come from rich family. We just come from family that God bless so that they are able to support us. So, I was there going up and down, but I said, no, I think I don't want to run. And I said, guess it's fine. If you feel like God, I don't want to go. So I read the Bible and I was reading Joseph's story and I was reading, you know, the story of Sadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You know that part where the king actually builds the golden image and he actually goes everyone to worship and the three boys they said no, we don't want to worship and Pharaoh takes them. You know, he says, okay, if you don't worship this time, I'm going to throw you the burning furnace, which was, you know, how many times? Seven times. And he said, oh Lord, it's not a problem. Let it be known. You should, in other words, you should know that if the God we serve will want us to perish there, we would rather perish than worship you. But if our God sees it okay, he is going to rescue us even from that burning furnace. I was thinking about that because they were willing even to die. But they did not die. God rescued them. And I said, if they were willing to die, I think I can also be willing to lose. It's fine. 4 years, minus plus 1 year, it's okay. So Saturday, I made sure that I was one of the first guys to be in church. And because I was also a chorister, I was choristering and everything. And Auntie saw me and said, what's happening to this boy? He's supposed to be sad. You know, she didn't know my secret, but it was about this three kids, boy's daughter plus Joseph. And later on, she met me and I spoke to her and, Auntie, it's okay. Son, no problem. Let's continue praying. The Lord is good. So we prayed because we had a minimum days on the Sabbath, but that was a count which I missed. But as we continued to pray for other tests, which was also restored on the Sabbath, 1 week passed. The second week, I received a call from the accounting department. And as they heard me say, "Is it Isaac?" I said, "Yes, it's Isaac." They didn't ask anything. They only said, "When are you ready to write your accounting test?"
Amen.
Now I've got the power to speak about it. But you know, during that moment, I could not speak a word anymore. You know, not because God answered my prayer, but because He is able.
Amen.
You know, I went down and I said, you know, it was a personal touch. Sometimes if you see me, I just want to shout and say, it's because of this. It's possible. It's possible. And I said, "We are ready to write. I'm ready to write the test even tomorrow." Because it was on a Thursday, and I said, "I'm ready to write the test even tomorrow," which was on a Friday. And I knew that 3 of my friends, they did not make it, who wrote on the Sabbath. And I asked if they can come along. The answer was yes. So I invited them. Friday we wrote the test, and Saturday we went to church. Friends, I don't know what is happening to you, but I know that I'm preaching to young people who also face the same tribulation, the same temptation. I know that I'm preaching to you. You are my friends, and I know that this is the struggle we go every day. And I just want to thank God because He made it possible that today we should come here. Because today we want to dedicate our lives. Today we want to consecrate our life. We just want God to really fulfill the plan He has for us. You know, sometimes there is something that you need to do, but then you know it's against the Bible. And then you find yourself like in the prison, and that's the time that God's speaking to you. Hold on a little longer. We can even go against the Bible. It's fine, God will understand. But the problem is we are postponing a lot where God wants us to be.
Yes.
And today we want to pray, especially for the young people who really want to dedicate their lives to Jesus, who say that, "Jesus, I'm weak, but you are strong."
Amen.
Who want to say, "Jesus, I want to experience," because Christianity is a personal experience. I actually want to truly experience this relationship between you and I want to see if it works, and I tell you it does.
Amen.
If I'm preaching to someone who wants God to help him, to give him power to overcome the temptations you face on a daily basis, I want you to stand up. I want you to stand up, and I'm going to call upon the man of God who will dedicate us to the Lord. I want to call upon Pastor Hall and Elder Alex just to come and offer a powerful prayer that may the Lord touch us and give us that which we want so that we may overcome our daily tribulations. And that the plans that God has for each one of us be truly fulfilled according to God's time. May the good Lord bless you. Our God, our loving Father in heaven, Thou who liveth and reigneth in the unity of Your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, who sitteth at Thy right hand, who have experienced all the lives that each one of us have gone through, and Thy Holy Spirit, hallowed be Thy name. Thank You, Lord, for this day, that we can remember the young people who are in church and also those who are outside who need to be in. This day that we have designated as the Youth Day, and that in this recognition that each one of our youth in this church, they are Your precious soul. It's Your desire, Lord, that they will be in Your kingdom.
Yes.
praising you, thanking you, worshiping you. Many a time in our youthful years, we do not understand the bigger picture that you have for us. We are so hasty in our decision, in our stubbornness, in our own level-headedness that we tend to move about in a way that we, our eyes, our feelings leads us. And yet patiently you have called us, reasoned with us, and as a loving Father, embraced us with your love. We pray for the young people in our church. We are the leaders tomorrow, leading out in the ministry of the gospel. May your grace and mercy be upon them. And we want to thank you, Lord, for the youth of our church, even the PJ English Church. They are vibrant lot, and they have been endowed with the talents that you have bestowed upon them. May they recognize their talents, and may they put to good use for the praise and glory of your name. And sometimes, Lord, in our life's journey, things may not work out the way that we would like to. And if that is a challenge and a hindrance and a discouragement and a disappointment, we pray, Lord, as we listen to your words and the experience of Joseph, though he did not know what was to befall him, but he was groomed to be the governor. And likewise, the young people here will be in leadership position someday that today they might not understand. We pray that thou will give them the wisdom and the spirit of the Holy Spirit to guide them in convicting them and leading them to greater height in their spiritual experience of Father. We thank you for our young people. And may you empower them and charge them to be faithful to you today, and even as your servant Joseph was faithful. And in the end, he was victorious, glorifying you. Thank you, Lord, for listening to our prayer. In Jesus' wonderful loving name we pray. Amen.
Our Lord, our God, we thank you for the youth. We thank you for adventist youth. We thank you for their willingness to serve you. We thank you for their fire, Lord. We thank you for your wonderful word, Lord, that you have shared us with us today. And Father, as these young people grow up, may I just pray, Lord, that you teach them to give them the wisdom so that they can discern between their needs and their wants. And may you bless them greatly and supply all their needs, Father. Lord, may you send the youth good mentors, good teachers, so that they will guide them, so that they will reach their full potential, Father. May you give us wisdom as pastors, as elders, as members of the church board, to guide them so that they become even better than us, Lord, and they will finish the job so that we can all go home, Lord. Give the youth humility, Lord, so that they respect the elders. Send good friends to them, Lord, as they grow up. When they finish university, send them good jobs, Father. When they are of the right age, Lord, send them a good wife and a good husband. Whatever it is, Lord, keep all of them safe. On the day when you come back, we will be there, they will be there, we will all rejoice together, Father. Thank you, Lord, for listening and answering our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.